Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Father, we want to thank and appreciate you for this privilege to be here again today. I want to exalt your holy name. I want to say thank you for bringing us together again this morning, able to be partaker of that which you want to do. We thank you, Lord God, for this season and time, because every season and time is in your hand. Father, we thank you because you already know about this time even before we were made, before we were created. Thank you because you have solutions for this time. Father, we give you all the praise in the name of Jesus. We thank you for this privilege, this opportunity to be blessed again this morning. And Lord God, we thank you because of the souls that you will save today. Thank you, Lord God, for many that you will heal today. We thank you, Lord God, for how you will manifest your greatness again in our lives today and in our families. Father, we are grateful in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord God, for everyone who has been sick and you've healed them. Thank you for those ones that you are healing. Thank you for families that you are healing. Thank you for lands that you are healing. Father, we give you all the praise in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord God, because you are more than able to bring an end to every calamity. You are more than able, Lord, to put an end to every evil. And so, Lord, we trust you that this has started and you will glorify yourself. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Father, we bring forth your word unto you this morning. Obviously, he sent forth his word, and his word healed them and deliver them from all their destruction. Lord, we bring your word before you. You have said wherever your word is sent forth, there will be healing. Let there be healing today in the name of Jesus. Let there be fulfillment of those things that you've promised us in the name of our Lord Jesus. You said where two or three are gathered in your name, there you are in their midst. Father, in this broadcast, we are more than two, we are more than three. We have no doubt that, Lord God, technology is not a barrier for your move, and so you are in our midst. Father, we appreciate you in the name of Jesus. Lord, please have your way today. Lord, please have your way today. Minister to every soul. Lord, speak to our heart. Heal our diseases. Heal our lands. Heal our jobs. Heal our businesses in the name of Jesus. From coast to coast. Father, glorify yourself in the name of our Lord Jesus. From coast to coast, Father, magnify your name in the name of Jesus. Father, I ask today that you will cause your name alone to be glorified in the name of Jesus. And when we finish this service, Lord, let's have reasons to say indeed the Lord has blessed us. Thank you, our Savior. Blessed be thy holy name. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Amen. Brethren, I want to welcome you warmly to today's broadcast. Wherever you are hearing the sound of my voice, or you are watching, either in the UAE or in any other part of the world, I want to believe that the Lord will divinely bless you mightily today in the name of our Lord Jesus. I want to believe that whatever you are trusting God for today, you will receive in the name of Jesus. And I want to also believe that the word of God that we're about to hear will draw you closer to God, give you assurance that this God that you serve is real, and give you the boldness to keep serving him even until the end in the name of Jesus. I'm praying for somebody who is hurting, somebody who is disturbed, that today the word of God will bring comfort to your soul in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And as many who, because of this COVID-19, have suffered one loss or the other, I'm praying for you that the Lord Almighty will intervene in your affairs and bring you peace again in the name of our Lord Jesus. And if there's someone who is going through one storm or the other, I pray by the power of the Almighty today that your storm will be over in the name of Jesus. Today is the last Friday in the month of March, and it's our last Friday service for those of us who are in the Middle East and North Africa. And we are trusting God that whatever the Lord has reserved for this month, he will give us everything today in the name of Jesus. If you believe that with me, you can say louder, amen. This morning, quickly, we'll be looking at a message titled, "And They Took the City." And they took the city. Brethren, our text is taken from Joshua chapter 6, the entire story from verse 1, but I'm going to be reading verse 20 to us because of our time. Joshua chapter 6 is the place I want you to study, and verse 20 is the place I'll be reading for us here. Joshua 6:20. So the people shouted when the priest blew with the trumpet, and it came to pass when the people heard the sound of the trumpet, and the people shouted with a great shout, that the wall fell down flat, so that the people went up into the city, every man straight before him, and they took the city. Bible says they took the city. What is it that you want the Lord to deliver into your hands? I pray today you will take it. You will take that your job. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, you will lay hold on righteousness. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, you will lay hold on that promise from your place of work. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, you will lay hold on peace in your family once again. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, there is this family that has been passing through one turbulent situation after the other again and again. And they've been asking, when will there be peace in our family? Today you will lay hold on that peace in the name of Jesus. The Bible said they took the city. Oh, what happened to the city? If you read from verse 1, the Bible says in Joshua chapter 6, verse 1, that the gate of Jericho was strictly shut. The Bible says neither come in or come out. I mean, it's almost similar to what we are having now in some cities of the world, including our own city, where there is a lockdown. But the kind of lockdown that the people experienced was a lockdown against them. You know, the people of Jericho knew, they've had what God had done, you know, through the children of Israel as they moved from Egypt to the land of Canaan. And so they've had it. And so because of this, they began to say, hey, if we don't do something about our city, these people are coming to take over. And so they locked the gate. I don't know who has locked the gates against you. Oh, somebody is there, you are actually aspiring to become something great in life, and suddenly death came and locked the city against you. That took your parents or your guardians. So there was nobody to sponsor you, to send you to the universities. So you dropped out, and then you began to struggle since then. There is another one that everything about your life was very straight until you met wrong friends. And as you began to meet, to work with wrong friends, they began to show you wrong things. You know, like the prodigal son, the Bible says he left home and he began to eat with the swine. You know, he joined himself to strange people. Maybe that happened to you, and that has affected your path. And it's becoming very difficult for you to catch up again in life. I'm praying for you this morning that the Lord Almighty will give you again your city in the name of our Lord Jesus. He will bring you to the place of rest again in the name of Jesus. So the children of Israel were altered. They were stopped. They were stopped from moving forward by the gate of Jericho, you know. The people, Bible said, they locked even themselves in. They neither went out or came in. So they themselves were ready to either die than open the gate. There are stubborn troubles like that. But I don't know what stubborn problems of life you are facing. I'm telling you this morning that the one that can remove every trouble will remove that stubborn problem in the name of Jesus Christ. You know, there are certain problems. They were against your grandfather. They were against your father. And then they are also monitoring you again. But I'm assuring you, this stubbornness will end today by the authority of Jesus in the name of Jesus Christ. So they got to the gate. God told them what to do. They marched around the city 7 days. And on the seventh day, march again. And when you have done that, you shout. You know, the frustration in the first 6 days is that they were not even allowed to say anything. So they just kept walking around. And I can imagine one or two people, I mean, who among us can keep quiet for 7 days? You know, so I can imagine one or two people saying, this is frustrating. This is not looking like it. Maybe this message is not coming straight to you the way you will want it. It doesn't look like it. Brethren, it didn't look like it when God told them to march around the city. But when God intervened, it was exactly what they needed. Brethren, I don't know what is not looking like it for you today. But I'm assuring you that if you are with me today, it will be exactly that the Lord will intervene in your affairs in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Brethren, I want you to know that that war fell, and the Bible said the people took the city. So when you have not taken the city, you may be experiencing a lot of things. When they were standing by that gate, what were they experiencing? Probably it's also, you know, likable to what you are, you know, I mean, it's similar to what you are also experiencing today in your life. For example, they were expressing frustration. I mean, just see the 7 days that they were walking around, and then more, a child will want to talk, and the mother will say, no, no, God said we shouldn't talk, you know. And then somebody that whose faith is not as strong as others will say, why can't we talk? And they probably will excuse that away, you know, from the march past and say, you can't go with us again. You have done what God has us not to do. You know, like that, frustration. Are you frustrated? What is frustrating you? Have you prayed severally and there is no answer? Have you been to places here and there, even some places that you would not want to go, you know, so that you could have solution to your problem? But yeah, the problem is expanding. Is that what is going on in your life? I want to assure you today that the Lord Almighty is going to intervene in your affairs in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. So in Proverbs 13 verse 12, Proverbs 13 12, the Bible says, hope deferred make the heart sick, but when the desire cometh, it's a tree of life. When somebody is expecting something and you cannot see it, you know, recently, you know, one or two people said they've taken my sample for COVID-19 test, and I can imagine what was going on in their heart until they see the result. Will I be negative? Will I be positive? If I am positive, what's going to happen to my little baby? I saw one video of a nurse saying, I quit. I don't know how genuine the video is. I've been posted to a place where, you know, I'm going to be taking care of COVID-19 patient, and I don't think I can do it. They should know my health history, and so on and so forth. She has already, you know, concluded that if she go do that job, she's going to be affected. A good number of people are expecting good report, but they've waited and waited, and the good report is not coming. You know, you've been checking for the alert. You've checked your bank account over and over again, and nothing good seems to be coming. You've been checking your message. Some flip their phone a million times a day looking for good news, and it never comes. There are people who visit their, you know, open their email again and again, check the spam, maybe something went to the spam, you know, check again and again, and in a day, some check like 100 times. But there's no good news. Oh, there are people who have, you know, submitted interview, their CV somewhere, they've gone for interview, they've even been promised, you know, but yet they wait and wait and they can't see the result of the promise. And they have started to say, is God going to do it? They're feeling frustrated. They've seen other people come to town after them, went to one or two interview, and even had offer from both. And then they made choices, and they chose the job they are doing now. And yet, they've been around for a long time. Some have done what we call visa change in the UAE, or they've done visa change like many times. You know, and yet, there is nothing coming up. They are frustrated. Oh yeah, the Bible says so, that hope deferred maketh the heart sick. Is your heart sick this morning? Is your heart sick? I know the man, Jesus, who can heal all the hearts, who can turn situations around. Brethren, it doesn't matter how long the desert has been there. It doesn't matter how long the dryness has been there. One day rain will remove all the dryness of the land. Brethren, the rain of abundance is going to fall upon you. You just need to have courage and hold on a little more. You know, they've done 6 days. Oh, hallelujah, they waited for the seventh day. They believed God and they walked around and their frustration disappeared. I'm praying for you this morning, your frustration will disappear in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We know the story of Peter in Luke chapter 5. In Luke chapter 5, the Bible said Peter and his colleague from verse 1, they were washing their nets because they had toiled all the night and then they caught nothing. Then Jesus came into the scene. And when Jesus showed up, Jesus looked at them and said, what's going on here? Can I use your boat to preach? Thank God they didn't say no. Are you there? Does it look as if your life is not bringing results as you want it? Jesus is asking, can I have your life for use? Can I send you on an errand? Can you be a mouthpiece for me? Can you preach to your neighbor where you live? Can you preach to that your colleague in the office? Can you tell somebody that Jesus loved them? Can you make your resources available for me? Can you let me use a bit of your money to propagate gospel? Jesus is asking somebody, what can I use in your life? Can you just be patient and be like Peter was? He was frustrated, but in his frustration, he was patient for Jesus to finish his message. And when Christ finished his message, Jesus gave him what he was looking for, which he didn't need at the end of the day anyway. A good number of things we are pursuing that's probably taking some people away from God are things that at the end of the day, you actually don't need it, because there are better things that God has in plan for you. Jesus told Peter, you know, this is what you've been toiling for all over the night. Yeah, now take it now. And then Peter got so much fish, and he even beckoned on his neighbors, you know, his blessings affected his neighbors positively. But Jesus had a bigger plan for him. And when Peter realized this bigger plan, he abandoned everything and he followed Jesus. Have you been frustrated and it seems as if things are not going to work for you? I'm praying for you today that everything will work for you. I say everything will work for you. Can you just close your eyes and talk to God and say, Father, Lord Jesus, as you stepped out into Peter's boat and into his life, step into my life today, remove every frustration. Whatever it is that has brought frustration to me, Father, remove from my life. Can you talk to God? Lord, remove frustration. Father, remove frustration from this moment. Let frustration be far from me. Let it be far from my household. Let it be far from my family. Every issue that has brought frustration to me, Father, intervene today and bring an end to them. Let my frustration end today in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, our Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. So, when you see in that Joshua 6:20, what we saw there is that their frustration ended. They entered into the city. They spoiled the city. They took everything they wanted in that city. In fact, they took every man, you know, man and their possession. The only people they spared was the people they promised, Rahab and her household. I'm trusting God that when the siege is over, you and your household will still be complete in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Brethren, when man has not taken his city, there might be poverty, there might be lack. I don't know how much supply they got before they got to the city of Jericho. But since the city of Jericho had locked their gate, it was impossible for the people of Israel to have additional supply. You know, whatever supply they had, it was depleting. You know, when this lockdown was about to start, people start stocking up. You know, people start running up and down to stock up the house. If the lockdown lasts more than, you know, they've planned, they will run out of supply. There are individuals whose supply seems to be okay at the beginning, but okay is never enough, because at some point, okay was depleted. The supply was depleted. And then, you know, maybe you are here when your salary seems to be okay, and then you are taking care of yourself, you are living a good life, and suddenly you have additional responsibility. Now you have wife, you have children, you have other family members far and near waiting on you to be of help to them, and now things are becoming difficult. And you've not been able to lay hold on the city. There are individuals who traveled into foreign countries thinking, in a year or two, I'll be able to take care of my parents. I saw one sorry case one day. I met the young man. I've not seen you for some time. He said, yeah, so where have you been? And then we got talking, and he said, my mother died. And he was an elderly man in his 50s. And yet I saw tears, and I said, oh, take heart. You know, the reason he was crying was because he left the mother at home, ran into his different country to go make some money and be able to return and take care of the mother. He has gone. Couldn't take care of his mother physically because he's traveled, and then where he went, the resources has not come as he expected. He couldn't even say anything to the mother when the mother was sick, so that made him sorrowful. Do you have a similar case? Is your supply so limited that it can only increase until you take the city? I'm praying for you today that the Lord will give you the city, and that your supply will not be depleted until the city is in your hand, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. What is it that you are expecting God to do? The Lord will do it for you beyond your expectation in the name of Jesus. Of course, you know that the people of God were expecting the gate to be removed, but the Lord fell the wall for them. But more than your expectation, the Lord will do for you in the name of Jesus. In 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 27, 1 Samuel 17, 27, you know, we see it says, and the people answered David and told him after this manner, saying, so shall it be to the man that killed Goliath. You know, Goliath was standing between the people of God and their rest for 40 days and 40 nights. He was just messing up their life. He will come up and then in the morning, and he will boast and say, if any of you have the courage. He wasn't talking to those guys at the war front. He was talking to Saul, because Saul, according to the Bible, was the tallest Israelite as of that time. So giant was talking to the other giant, but the giant he was talking to was hibernating, hiding in his palace. So he would boom and shout at these guys, and there was nothing they could do until this young shepherd came in. And when he came, he said, this man that is standing here, what is behind him? If we remove him, what are we going to get? As a person, what will I get if I remove him? And they said, if you remove him, the king will make you his in-law. He will make your family the richest in the land. There is abundance for anyone that can remove him. Brethren, there is a gate between you and your city. When God removes it, abundance is behind it. And God is moving that gate today in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. You know that same day that David intervened, that God intervened through David, that was the last day of Goliath. And I'm praying for you today that whatever it is that is bringing lack, poverty into your life, insufficiency, that Lord is removing it today in the name of Jesus Christ. I want you to lift up your right and talk to God and say, Father, you are the same God that intervened for the people of Israel by the wall of Jericho. Intervene for me today. Intervene in my life. Intervene in my family. You remove Goliath, and
and there is a fulfillment of promise in the life of David, because the king said, this is what I will do. But until Goliath fell, the king didn't do it to any man. And so, Lord, I know there is a city that you want to give me. You want to give me rest. You want to give me abundance. You don't want me to live in lack. You don't want me to live in poverty. And so I ask, Lord God, even as you intervene in the time of old, intervene in my life. Can you talk to God? Can you talk to God? Father, intervene in the name of Jesus. And the Lord will intervene concerning you and your family in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, our Father. Blessed be thy holy name, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Where others have failed, you will not fail. Several warriors had failed. Even if you think it was in the gene of David, Eliab, his brother, and the rest, they had failed. But God made David to succeed. You will succeed in Jesus' mighty name. Brethren, sometimes when a man is standing, you know, has not taken over the city, because there is a city of peace, there's a city of rest, there is a city of good health. When a man has not taken it, he may suffer from some chronic and shameful ailment. You know, there are certain ailments some kept to themselves. You know, you just hear that somebody died, and then they say, no, he's been sick for some time, but he didn't tell anybody. Shame will not let him say it. You know, I pray for you today that you will not die of shame. You will not die of sickness. You will not die of diseases. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, whatsoever it is that seems difficult, the Lord will solve it for you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. There are testimonies. When people think it's impossible, God just showed up. And there are people hearing me right away or watching this who have seen God move in their situation before. That same God will move again for you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Brethren, are you suffering from any form of ailment, any chronic ailment, any disease, any sickness in your body? I pray this morning that the hand of the Lord rest upon you and remove this sickness in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. There was a woman whose own city that he wanted to take was city of peace. He just wanted healing. She wanted healing. You know, the Bible says she had suffered, you know, for 12 years. The ailment has, you know, finished up physically, finished up financially. She had become guinea pig for every doctor. But the Bible says one day she encountered Jesus. In Matthew chapter 9, verse 21, Matthew 9:21, she told herself something. What are you telling yourself? She told herself, Bible says in Matthew 9:21, if I may but touch his garment, I shall be whole. You know, our faith rose up. Is your faith rising up this morning? Do you still believe you can take the city? Brethren, I know I can take the city. I know. I've seen myself taking a lot of cities. Brethren, do you see yourself taking the city? Do you see God intervening in your affairs? Do you see him removing your pain and your sorrow? Do you see him intervening and lifting you up beyond your expectation? That's what God can do. That's what he has done. That's what he did for this woman. The Bible said the woman said within her, I don't need to be prayed for. I don't need him to lay hands on my head. I don't need to do any 3 days fasting. I don't need to do, I know if I can hold the hem of his garment. That is faith. But I said faith coming by hearing. Hearing by the word of God. And that's why you should not listen to those who propagate fear all around you. If you have a friend who talks about impossibility all the time, brethren, if you remain with the friend, you will never see possibility. But if you want to see possibility, sever yourself from such a friend. Look for another friend. There are a lot of friends. I have a lot of good friends who talk about positivity alone. They just know that it is possible. They are not limited by anything. And I mean anything. Nothing limits them. Their bank account does not determine for them what they venture into. What they venture into is determined for them by their faith in the word of God. Do you have faith in the word of God? This woman said, if I touch the hem of his garment, it doesn't need to come to my house. He doesn't need to even see me physically. I don't need to be in his front. Anywhere I can touch the hem of his garment. From the back, from the side. I'm okay if I'm able to touch the hem of his garment. And you have expectation from God. Even as we said, we'll be broadcasting today. What is your expectation for this broadcast? For you, is it just another statistics? Oh, we listened. Oh, we watched it. Do you just want to confirm to me later that you watched what I ministered? Is that all you want to do? Or you have an expectation. The Bible said the expectation of the righteous shall not be cut short. This woman had expectation. I don't know the number of the people, but the Bible said there was a massive crowd pressing on him. And in verse 22, you see that Jesus turned about, Matthew 9:22, Jesus turned him about, and when he saw her, he said, daughter, be of good comfort. thy faith has made thee whole. That's what made you whole, your faith. The faith in the word of God was what made the people of Israel to stand by the gate of Jericho. Everybody was healthy, no ailment, no diseases, because they had faith in what God had told them that he was going to give them the city. Are you looking for healing as well? Are you there like this woman? Can you just have faith this morning that as we pray, the Lord will heal you? Shall we close our eyes and talk to God and say, Father, every ailment and disease and sickness in my body, I command by the authority of Jesus and by the faith that I have in the word of God, that the Bible says he sent forth his word and his word healed them, that this morning I receive healing and I move into the city of peace in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. From this moment, I operate divine health in the name of Jesus. Jesus was never sick. From this moment, I will be sick no more in the name of Jesus. Every sickness that was in my body even before this prayer, I look and see them no more in the name of Jesus. Thank you, our Father. In Jesus' name we pray. I trust that your testimony is coming very soon in the name of Jesus. Men and women will rejoice with good that, with you that God indeed has done you good. In the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. Lord, we give you praise. Blessed be thy name, O Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Lastly, as I'm trying to bring the message to an end, what is other thing that will be there for those who are standing, waiting for God to do something, who are yet to take their city? Maybe there will be hopelessness. That's number 14. In addition to frustration, poverty, chronic and shameful ailment, there may also be hopelessness. Brethren, there are many days of hopelessness. But there is a God that restores hope. He's the hope restorer. The Bible said when they were traveling, you remember that story where Jesus healed the madman of Gadarene? Yeah, shortly before they got to that man, they were almost drowned, including Jesus. But Jesus was there in the boat sleeping. How will you be drowning and be sleeping? It's because there was hope. And the disciples who thought they were hopeless were running up and down. In fact, they came to him and said, don't you care that we perish? We know that if you die, you're going to go back to your father. And you know, you actually came to just be with us for a short time. But should we die like you? Don't you care that we die? And he laughed. And the Bible said he just rebuked the storm. And then shortly after that, he went and healed that man of Gadarene. Brethren, of course, the family members of that madman of Gadarene had lost hope. Because the Bible said they've done everything they should do. Everything they could do as human, they've taken him to healers. They've taken him to everywhere they could take him to. But the Bible said everywhere they took him to, he broke the chain and, you know, freed himself and went into the wild again. And finally, he had moved, you know, he had moved himself in, not only just into the grave, but into the tomb. So he was a tomb raider, living in the tomb. I don't know what your situation is. Do you have any member of the family who had left home, who is no more listening to anybody? Do you have anyone who is actually losing his mind or who has completely lost their mind? Do you have anybody who is taking, you know, mind-bending drugs and all kind of stuff? Do you have people who are no more listening to God? You have people who, you know, you are sorrowing over even though they are alive. The Lord will intervene to them. Is there any hopelessness around you? Is it that you have studied and then to use the certificate is a problem and you are becoming hopeless? You are counting days, you know? Are you counting years and you are saying, this is my age, I'm not sure anybody is coming around me again, I'm not sure I'm going to see someone to marry? Are you there, everywhere you go for a job, they say they want somebody younger than your age? Are you there, the course you read seems like obsolete now, and then there are new courses, and it's like you're not going to get a job? May I tell you this morning, there's a God that can restore hope. Oh, they were standing by that gate, and any man who didn't hear from God directly, I'm sure will be, you know, questioning Joshua and saying, why did you bring us to this gate? And let's pull the wall. Let's see what we can do. Why should we be standing by the wall and doing nothing? They had no hope that something was going to happen, but God intervened because he promised. The Bible said, faithful is he that has said it, for he will do it. What has God said he will do in your life in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ? In Mark chapter 10, verse 46 to 52, Mark 10, 46 to 52, the Bible said they came to Jericho, same Jericho. And as Jesus was coming out of Jericho, there was a blind man. You know, this blind man could not see. There was no hope of seeing. I don't know where he had gone. Maybe the best eye hospitals. Maybe he had met the best eye doctors. But nothing positive was coming. But on this occasion, Jesus came. Oh, maybe nothing positive has been coming your way, but Jesus will come your way in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Because your day must come. You know, if you look at the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, said, give us this day our daily bread. Why? Because hunger is not allowed to go beyond the day. No sorrow is allowed to go beyond the day. Every day there is solution. And today there is solution in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Your hopelessness is ending right away in the name of Jesus. When I know what I'm talking about. You know, I've seen this God intervene in my affairs. I've entered a city in the past with one bag on my shoulder. I left 12 years later, you know, leaving a house behind there. This is what God can do. Brethren, this is what God can do. He said, in righteousness shall thou be established, and thou shalt be far from your oppression. The Lord will restore your hope. As men that have lost their hope, the Lord will restore your hope in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. I pray for you this morning. Hopelessness is no more your portion. I don't know where blind Bartimaeus will have got that eyes except by the intervention of Jesus. Where else will your hope be restored except in Christ? And your hope is restored today in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Lift up your hand and pray with me. Say, Father, everything that has brought hopelessness into my life, Father, remove them or put them in the name of Jesus. Go into the root of my hopelessness, Father, and let it be removed in the name of Jesus. There is no room for hopelessness again in my life from this moment. No room for hopelessness in my family in the name of our Lord Jesus. Thank you, our Father. Blessed be thy holy name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Brethren, there are several other examples in the Bible, both in the Old and the New Testament. Oh, the madman of Gadarene, like I said, there was no hope, no way. The family had lost hope on him. I don't even think they were looking for him again. Of course, if they were, they would not have allowed him to be living in the tomb. But Jesus met him. You know, your path will cross with Christ today in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And of course, you know the story of Joseph the dreamer. The father never thought of seeing him again. As far as the father was concerned, Joseph was gone. As far as Jacob was concerned, they've told him he was dead. He had believed them. He saw his clothes. He kept it as memorial. But that's all. Are you there? Are you keeping some negative memorial? The Lord will change your story. Oh, I know it cannot work again. No. It will work again for you. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Of course, you know about Isaac himself. You know, he was supposed to be the heir of his father Abraham. But whenever he went to the well that his father dug, they fought with him. They struggled with him. They never let him have the well, even though it belonged to his father. You know, and they continue to struggle with him, but God took him to Rehoboth. You get to your Rehoboth today in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. I say you get to your Rehoboth today in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. But in all these cases of people whose hope were restored, they have one common factor. Brethren, I said all the men who took their cities had one common factor. And I'm trusting God that common factor, even you too, will partake of it today in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. The first one is obedience. Did you hear me clearly? Obedience. Obedience is not you doing what you want to do, when you want to do it, and how you want to do it. That's not obedience. The Bible tells us about the father who had two sons. He told the first one, said, go for me. And the son said, I will not go. But later on, he changed his mind and he went. And then he told the second son, go for me. And he said, I'm on my way. I'm going. But he never went. And Jesus Christ asked, which of the sons is better? And a lot of people, scholars, have given answers. But thank God for our Father and the Lord, Pastor Adeboye. He told us, neither of the sons is good. And truly, I have sons as well. I don't want my son to look at me face to face when I send him on an errand and he will say, I will not go. I don't want that. And I don't want a son that will tell me, I will go. And then I keep waiting and he will not go. I don't want that as well. So when our Father and the Lord told us that neither of the son is good, I think he's right. There's no need to doubt it. Oh, I don't know. Maybe the mother called the boy and said, hey, how can you tell your father like that? Please go. That's a nice thing. But the son was wrong by saying he will not go. Brethren, obedience is not you doing it the way you want to do it. Some can even calculate more than God these days. You know, they don't want it mentioned even. They don't want to hear tight. Brethren, the reason why it is never tight for me from day one is because I don't joke with my tithe. I don't joke with it. Of course, I know you are hearing me. You don't necessarily worship with me. And so when I'm talking about tithe, it's not about you bringing it to me. God is more than able to do his work. He is doing it. Are you listening to me? But if you want to obey God, you obey God. You want to serve God, serve God in totality. Don't serve God with your heart and keep your pulse away from him. Your pulse is part of your heart. There are some that can serve God, but they can't use their time for God. So I can go to church, but I can't spend one minute extra. I can't do anything. Oh, you say you are very good. You know, a lot of people excellent in media, and then they come to that church, they look at the media of the church and say, ah, look at the media, this is nothing. I know far better than this. If you do, why don't you just walk in there and do something? I remember one young man, God bless him. I mean, they're not just one of them. A good number of people have come across them, being part of the ministry to bless us at one time or the other, you know, to play one role or the other. But this young man was particularly sitting in the congregation and was hearing the keyboard and said, I can play better than this. And the person sitting near him said, oh, the pastor is liberal. Talk to him. He will take you through what needs to be taken through, and then you will do. And then he came and said, sir, I can play this keyboard. And then we got talking. God, I said, even the son of a pastor is a worker. You know, he's a wonderful brother. And I said, okay, that's great. We'll bring your letter. And suddenly, you know, the church just turned around. For him and all his colleagues that joined the choir, then made the choir to be, you know, something far better than what we had. That's how God wants you to do. If God is prompting you to go do something for him, go do it, because that thing will be done, my brother. If he asks you to do something for him, he's also telling someone else to do something as well. So I can assure you, if you don't do it on time, someone else will do it. And when someone else do it, you will remember that, oh, God told me first. This happens severally, even in individual lives. There might be one or two people that God told, hey, there is something that I'm about to do. You go start stocking up this particular item because it will be required. You know? There are certain items now, as we talk now, in our nations that are no more available, like hand sanitizer. You know, people are being mass production now to catch up. And if God had told someone some months ago and say, hey, prepare hand sanitizer, he would say, what for? Yeah, I'm a banker. What do I need hand sanitizer for? I'm not a chemist. But God knows why he's telling you. I don't know what else God is telling you now. But whatever God is telling you, obey him. In the spiritual, obey him. In the physical, obey him. Whatever the Lord is expecting you to do, go ahead and do it. Isaiah 1:19 says, Isaiah chapter 1 verse 19, if ye be willing, willingness must be there, and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. So there is still good in the land, but you must be willing. You must be willing to obey his instruction. In Psalm 119 verse 111, the Bible says, thy testimonies have I taken as an heritage forever, for they are the rejoicing of my heart. The testimonies of the Lord, whatever the Lord tells me, whatever the Lord makes me, asks me to do, they become my rejoicing. They become the rejoicing of my heart. I look for, even when things were the way they were many years ago, I look forward for the service day. I've worked 6 days a week, and then on Sunday, I need to go minister. I look forward to Sunday. A good number of people sleep in their home on that Sunday. They rest and sleep and sleep. But when I get to work on Monday, they ask me how was yesterday. I say, wonderful. Because they expected us to go sleep on Sunday. But that Sunday, I looked forward to it again and again. Just the way I look forward to Friday now. Are you the one who use your, like in the UAE, Friday is the day of Sabbath. But for you, that's your day of rest. That's the day you sleep and watch all the films. Brethren, you are not obeying God. You know God is prompting you to go join the people of God, to go serve God with them. If you don't listen to God, there's no way you will be able to take the city. Some took the city when they were busy doing their obedience. We have some media guru now. What they were doing was to do media for church, and they were, you know, honing their skill, and then suddenly they just think, okay, why don't I commercialize some aspect of this, not within the church, outside of the church, and they became the household name for events. And then, you know, their media now, technology supported it, and they are a big name. You know, we used to know some people who were in technical, you know, and suddenly they have their own studio, they have this, they have that. They started in the church. And they, of course, you know, I don't need to tell you about wonderful singers who the Lord is blessing massively, but they just surrender themselves to work for God. And God, you know, gave them a ministry that is taking them to places. If you obey God, you take over the city. You won't be able to take over the city without obedience. It can't be by your way. If God is the one to help you, then you have to listen to God. May the Lord help you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. The second thing you need to have is patience. Somebody say patience. Yes, patience. Patience. You need to be patient. If you are not patient, if you just want to do it your way, you're in a hurry, you won't be able to make it the way God wants you to make it. Brethren, is there any man? God does not serve, you know, he doesn't serve fast food. You need to be patient with God. When Jesus took the boat of Peter was patient. It was after Jesus finished speaking. You go read Luke chapter 5. It said when he finished speaking, then he ministered to Peter personally. God wants to see you after the service, but you have gone before in the middle of the service. You are the one who feel comfortable in places where people laugh away their life. You know, you are comfortable where they laugh, where they joke. But when you come to church, you check time all the time. We don't also hold people in church. We let them go on time because we know that, you know, their businesses are outside there. They need to go do their business. But don't watch time for God. He owns all the time. You know, and don't be boastful of the time you spent in his presence. Say, ah, no, I spent like 2 hours. Oh, he's the Ancient of Days. Your 2 hours means nothing. He's watching over you day and night. Day and night he's watching over you. And so be patient with God. Some have done some little thing for God. They said, you know, I gave my offering, I gave my tithe, and yet things are not going the way I want it to go. Wonderful. What have you given God? He owns everything. He said, oh, I have fasted, yet I've not seen result. Be patient, my brother. You are fasting to who? To God? He doesn't eat. Have you seen him eating? You just only fasted a few days and you are complaining. This God you're talking about does not eat at all. He says, sir, you don't know how long I've been praying. I've prayed so much. Yeah, who are you praying to? To God, is it not? So, brethren, whatever it is that you're doing, be patient. The Lord is going to reward you. He actually commanded us to hold no man nothing. So, if he has told us not to hold any man, he doesn't hold us well. And he will give you the city in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Brethren, finally, on what you need to do, I mean, second to the last, you also need to be filled by the word of God. The devil does not understand, I match you. No. What devil understands is the word of God. So, if you're going to take the city, why should the city be handed over to you? It should be by the word. It's the word of God that can open doors. In Matthew, in Proverbs chapter 18, verse 20, Proverbs 18, 20, the Bible says, a man's belly shall be satisfied with the fruit of his mouth, and with the increase of his leaves shall he be filled. Do you want to take over the city? Speak positive words. Speak the word that you have discovered in the Bible. Speak the word that match exactly what you want. Don't be saying something and be doing something else. I mean, don't be expecting something and be saying some negative things from your mouth. You know, someone told me a secret some time ago. Said, don't ever tell someone you don't have. The best you tell him is give me some time. Oh, I need 5,000 dirhams from you. Okay, that's give me some time. And then within the time, there is something that God will provide for you. It can be a quarter of that, it can be a tenth of that. Put it in the envelope. See the fellow and say, brother, let's trust God that God will multiply this for you. This is what I can do now. And then that's it. And then God will multiply it even as you already have faith. If you keep saying you don't have, you will never have. If you keep saying it is not possible, it will never be possible. So if you're going to take the city, if you look at it, you know, you don't look at this city. Dubai is a beautiful place. You don't look at Dubai and say, me? If I can just get a job now where I can be pushing wheelbarrow, my God, what just came out of your mouth? What just came out of your mouth? You will be surprised. When you push your wheelbarrow, you will be reported to somebody who didn't have half of your education, but who has spoken positively into his own life. And so they knew it was possible. The woman with the issue of blood said, if I can touch. It's not like the angel is coming. Let's go and see today. Anyway, I've been seen. No. Say something good. Say something positive. Say something wonderful. Say something that aligns you to the miracle that God is about to do in your life. Are you listening to me? So watch what you say. Say only the word of God. What has the word said about your situation? That's what you need to say. Somebody is there. You are afraid when I grow old. What's going to happen to me? What will happen to you? You enjoy your old age in abundance, in the name of Jesus, in good health. There's no weary among them, no feeble one. That's the way you should view it. View your future with positivity. Take over the city with the word of God, not by fear. And the Lord will help you in Jesus' mighty name. I said the Lord will help you in Jesus' mighty name. Finally, brethren, by strength shall no man prevail. 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 9. You won't be able to struggle and take the city by yourself. That's why they didn't use a single weapon at that gate. They stood by the gate. They walked around the wall. And then they shouted, tell me, what instrument of war did they use? I remember my physics teacher in those days about, 35 or more years ago. He said, don't mind them. They use supersonic sound. I remember now. They use supersonic sound. I said, sir, if ordinary people can use supersonic sound with their mouth, that's also a miracle, isn't it? If it was supersonic sound coming out of the mouth of men, that is super. Is it not? Brethren, by strength shall no man prevail. Your effort cannot help you.
There is only one way.
I don't know many ways. There is only one way. Where I stand now, I'm on the 13th floor of a building. If I'm coming down, I need to go by the lift. If they say don't use the lift, then I will use the staircase. If you see anybody use something different, they will put him in the body bag. There's no other way. The only way is Jesus. That's the way that I know. I can only tell you about the way that I know. I don't know who else you are listening to. Brethren, but the way out of trouble, Jesus Christ said, I am the way. Is the way out of trouble. Is the way into the city that you want to take. No. Defrauding others will not take you into abundance. It will take you into fear. When they ring your bell, you think the police have come for you. And thank God for the city where we live. They have record of every man. Brethren, may I tell you something? Is there anything you need from God? Is there anything you want the Lord to do for you? Then hold on Him. Accept Jesus into your life. Stop leading yourself. You're not making anything good out of your life. The woman with the issue of blood knew what to do. She said, I will hold the hem of his garment. Blind Bartimaeus knew what to do. He shouted him more. They told him, keep quiet. He shouted him more. And when Jesus said, come, he ran to him. The garment that was disturbing him, he left it. What is the garment disturbing you? What will not let you come to Jesus? Your friends? Oh, you need to see what friends say when people fail. When you fail, your friends will be the first to laugh. You know, when you fail, your friends will be the first to laugh at you. These are the friends that made you not to come to Jesus. Oh, no. My caliber. Your caliber, they will come to your graveside when you fast, you know, your fast lane lifestyle lead to your death. They will come to your graveside. They will be part of lowering you. They will bid you farewell. And when they leave there, they're going to give their life to Jesus. Some will even give their life at your funeral when the pastor makes altar call. Because they will look at you. You become their example, their negative example, the guinea pig, and then they change and then begin to serve God. And finally, let me ask you a question. Since you've been leading yourself, have you led yourself to take over the city? Has it worked for you? Jesus will make it work for you. I said, Jesus will make it work for you. I want you to bow down your head if you want to give your life to Jesus. Bow down your head and lift up your right hand and say, Father, I know I'm a sinner. And I know I cannot help myself. I come to you today to confess my sin and to forsake my evil way. From this moment, come into my life, save my soul, write my name in the book of life, give me the grace to serve you all the days of my life, give me the grace to follow you till the end. Thank you, Lord, for saving me, for in Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Father, in the name of Jesus, as many who have prayed this prayer of faith, I commit them unto your hands. Even those who have backslided before, they are coming back to you. Lord, I ask that you show them your mercy and forgive them their sins. Lord, write their names in the book of life. Lord, I pray that from this moment, the grace to serve you release upon them. Help them that they will never go back into the world. Thank you, Lord, for saving the souls of this your children. For in Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. If you have prayed that prayer and you have genuinely confessed your sin and you are forsaking your old ways and you want to follow Jesus all the ways of your life, I want you to get across to us. You know, get across to us through any means. You can get across to us through comments here and one of us will contact you. And then you can also, you know, get across to us if you're on our WhatsApp group, you know, and then one of us will get across to you. And if you want to talk to me directly, you can get across to me and then I will cancel you. My number is +971 +971 50 798 3504. Again, +971 50 798 3504. God bless you as you contact us, and the Lord will uphold you to the end in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. For as many who believe that they are children of God and they are serving God faithfully, but they be standing by that gate and the gate seems not to open, it's because the Lord wants to fall the wall for you. Brother once told us many years ago, and it worked for us. He said, if you are looking for a room to rent and you can't find the money, then it means that one room is not meant for you. Start looking for something bigger and better. And brethren, you know, faith cometh by hearing. We believe that. and it worked for us. We have fantastic testimonies around that as well. And so if you are standing by that gate and the gate is not opening, it's because the gate is too narrow for you. The Lord wants to fall the wall today, and the wall will fall even before we leave here in the name of Jesus Christ. I have a few minutes more here. Just I want to bow down your head as we pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus, you know what your children are passing through. You know as many that are waiting and standing and say, Lord, I won't go elsewhere. I'm only standing by you. As many that are holding on your word, waiting for you to do something in their life. Lord, I ask today that you intervene for these ones in the name of Jesus. Those who are sick and trusting you for healing, I pray by the authority of Jesus, receive your healing now in the name of Jesus. Those who are in one trouble or the other, the devil might even be justified to hold them in that trouble. But by the authority of Jesus, your word says the lawful captive shall be delivered. So I ask for their deliverance even now in the name of Jesus. As men that have been put into trouble by wrong friends, Father, I pray today, Lord God, that you intervene in their affairs in the name of Jesus. Those who are looking for job, I pray, Lord God, that you create their own job. You created a seat for Esther by removing Vashti. Vashti just woke up and she moved herself out of the throne because an Esther is coming to take it. I pray today, Lord God, that you create new seats for your children in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, I ask for favor for as many that lack favor. Lord, it's part of your promise to your own children. But Jesus Christ grew in wisdom and in stature. In found favor with God and with man. Lord, we say we are joint heirs with Christ. I pray for your children who needs favor to move to the next level of their life. Receive that favor in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And as many that have people who have been bedridden, who are in one trouble or the other, by the authority of Jesus, I ask right away that the Lord intervene in that situation in the name of Jesus. Homes where the enemy is threatening them and there is no peace, I say peace return into that home in the name of Jesus Christ. As many who have been married and are trusting God for children, I ask God to open that womb now and deliver your Samuel unto you in the name of our Lord Jesus. And I pray for as many who are counting days and saying, will I ever be married? Time is going. I pray that this year is your year in the name of our Lord Jesus. This year is your year of miracle in the name of Jesus. In this same season where people are saying there is a casting down, I pray for a lifting up for you in the name of Jesus. And as many ministries that are passing through turbulent time, I pray that the peace of the Lord, that the grace upon our Father the Lord, Pastor E. Adeboye, be released upon your ministry right away in the name of Jesus. As many whose ministry are hidden and are not fruitful, I pray today the same God that made John the Baptist to be fruitful even right at the back of the wilderness and desert, that same God will intervene for you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. What is it that you are passing through? I ask by the authority of Jesus that since Jesus is with you, those problems are over in the name of Jesus. And for us, we that are saying, when will I have rest? You are struggling, you are toiling like Peter. Today I decree in the name of Jesus, the same way Christ encountered Peter, you are encountered and your toiling is over in the name of Jesus. And as many that are finding difficult to make up their mind, to surrender totally to serve God, I ask that God make it easy for you in the name of Jesus. The Holy Spirit came upon Peter and his life changed from being afraid to and being followed from following Jesus from afar. He began to minister, leading 3,000 souls to Christ in one day. I pray for you today a complete transformation by the help of the Holy Spirit in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. Lord, I lift your people under your banner. And I ask, Lord God, that this COVID-19 will pass without your children being affected in any way in the name of Jesus. Your peace, Lord God, that surpasses the understanding of men will be upon every soul that trusts you in the name of Jesus. And for the sake of the elect, even as you have brought evil to an end in China, you will bring evil to an end in every other nation, Nigeria, United Arab Emirates, every nation of the world in the name of Jesus. Lord, we pray peace into Italy, peace into Spain, peace into Iran, peace into the US, peace into every continent of the world right now in the name of Jesus. Even where stories are not coming out in like North Korea and the rest, I ask that peace of God go there in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. Lord, we give you praise. Blessed be thy holy name. For in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen and amen. Lord, we thank you because you've answered us. Blessed be thy name. People of God, I want to thank you. Some of you, I saw your comment. Thank you, Brother Moses, Cosma, and several others who have commented before now. God bless you. Kite Moses was a blessing to our ministry many, many years ago when he came here as a pilot student in the UAE. God bless you again and again, and all your colleagues who made things beautiful then, in the name of Jesus. I want to invite you for our service again on Wednesday, UAE time, 7 p.m. Please join us. And if the Lord lead us to come your way before then, definitely we will come. We are ready to obey God and do whatever He wants us to do. So on Wednesday by 7 p.m. UAE time, please come and be part of the blessings. And the Lord of hosts will surprise you in the name of Jesus. We are trusting God that very soon we'll be able to return to physical church and continue to, you know, worship together again. But until then, will we continue to minister to one another this way? And the Lord will answer prayer wherever we are. We answer our prayers in Jesus' name. God bless you and be with you in Jesus' name. Amen.